So here we are on the set of the One Up Show, and let's go look around a bit. It's about 4 hours or so to put together this set. It's they do a really good job, you know, creating the environment of an office-like atmosphere. Dude, who was on my computer last? What the hell? Mikey, were you messing with this?
Dude, I had to reinstall Avid.
Rob!
I'm sorry.
We're gonna have to clear out, guys.
Dude, the thing keeps crashing.
We're bringing in the set now. Let's move. Okay. We're bringing in the set.
Alright.
Oh, man. Hey, Melissa.
This is my most important prop. See, you'll watch the transformation at work. It's like, chain. See? Here I am.
The Jane comes alive.
Immediately raises my IQ by like 10 points at least.
So let's head back up. Check out the other part of the studio. So here we are. They're about to go and do their scene here with Crispin in Crispin's office. So here we go.
Hi, Crispin.
Hey, how's it going?
I just don't think you're doing a very good job.
All right, wait, let's calm down here, all right. Action.
Am I acting anymore?
It's not, so you were saying about Adama.
Adama is essentially, line?
Good.
It's good. And
you thought it was good.
No,
remember
that's
what we
not
talked
the line. Line
what we talked
good.
About earlier was that you didn't
Where's
like
the script?
It. I was gonna like it. That
Where's
was
the script?
That was the
Where's
thing
80?
We worked
hey,
on.
Hey, you guys are totally in the shot. You're gonna need to get out of the way.
Oh, sorry.
Definitely, like, my interest in this game was really high until I started playing it,
yeah.
And the more frustrated I got with
I
it.
I absolutely love the idea of it. Like, just wacky pinball and objective-based pinball, but the execution is just not that great.
See, yeah. I'm not really even that infatuated with the idea.
Really?
Like, the idea, pretty much, like, from hearing about it to playing it, I
is
was...
Is it just the... I know you hate the talking thing.
Rally. Charge. Beat shit up.
Is that
well,
why?
The thing is, like, the talking thing is so still counterintuitive and is so unproductive as a mechanic to use to guide anything. And that, you have these, like, in this game in particular, you have these very critical moments where, like, you need them to rally
yeah.
now. And you
yeah.
say rally, and they don't respond, because you can tell when they respond, because these little bubbles will pop up all over the screen,
right.
which is totally a poor mechanic, too, because it's like, hey, now your vision's obstructed
right.
completely. Is the ball lost in bubbles? It's absurd. Speed off of the flipper is really hard to gauge.
Oh yeah.
Like there's no it's sort of like random between when you get like a good hit and you generate some velocity and then when it just like trickles off like a first grader at a wiffle bat.
You're trying to tilt the landscape to get to a certain item. Like you definitely want to get the little green balls because that makes it easier to add more troops to your side. But it's just like painful like you tilt the table and you see the ball just kind of slowly
yeah,
roll
yeah.
over. and then hit it, and then you got to wait for it to roll back down. It's just not a very good pinball game because it's so slow-paced.
It's like the Mash of Styles. It's like pinball is kind of out of control, and you have to do what you can to control the ball. But the real-time strategy stuff, you have to have absolute control over it to feel like you're accomplishing something, and that there's just a big clash, like a disconnect.
Did you get sick of being berated by the game? like you fail a map, and the dude will ask you, like, are you serious? You want to try again?
There are only so many times you can try.
Yeah, you're... And then finally...
Don't tell me to turn it off, game, because I will.
Finally, you click retry, and it just says, ha-ha, and it's like, great, I'm stuck.
The problem with this game that I had with this game is that there's so much micromanaging for a pinball game. It's too much.
Well, it's like when things are going well, it's pretty fun, but, like, there's levels with rivers, and sometimes it's pretty easy to open the dam on the rivers and wash all of your guys away like that.
Yeah.
That pissed me off.
Yeah.
That's when I was shouting things into the mic that the game didn't understand.
Did you hit a brick wall at stage 4? Like, that was the stage that, for me, that was the stage where it was just, like, the difficulty. It was like a cock block.
Yeah, the first boss fight.
It's just stupid.
But I noticed you can't just beat the levels. You have to beat them with a lot of troops, or you got to start over the last level.
That was the problem with stage 4.
Yeah, that was stage 4.
Skip had played so poorly leading up to it that...
I did what I could with the resources available to me. I thought I fought valiantly.
You're a bad player. I think for some people, that sort of masochism is going to be a good thing. Like, for you, that's you were ready to give it a 3, and I think Friday when I left work, I was, like, totally in the 4 range.
I threw my controller a couple times, and I think I kicked the beanbag.
Well, like, Saturday and Sunday while I was here all day screwing around with it, I threw your controller a lot, too.
Oh, thanks.
Again, like, as I sit here and, you know, piss and moan, I did keep running over to your desk.
You
to
were
play
there.
It. I did keep coming back
every
to
10
play
minutes.
It, so I don't know that on the merit of it simply being a GameCube game would I say go buy.
Yeah. Like, if you're starving for a GameCube game, I guess.
But, like, I mean, but like, famished.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, emaciated from lack of small discs in your gaming diet.
You know, when we first got to play it at different trade shows, it seemed really cool, but the more time we spend with it, I don't know. I'll see how you feel once you get to the spider shrine.
I think I'm done with it.
Oh. Yeah, you'll be back at my desk after 10 minutes after we turn the camera off.
I want to beat this one just because I've only tried this particular stage.
Let's go back to level 4.
Let's not, actually.
Oh, yeah, there you are, Cesar. Just putting on my coat. You know, we don't like to be just here trapped on the set here on the 1UP show. We like to go off to different locations, so let's go on a little trip.
Meeting. So I play during the day, thinking like I can be loud, but also I gotta be with the old ones. Are we on? Are we?
Yeah.
Okay.
We're always on. So who are you, John? Very nice to meet you.
Who am I? That's a very good question. I used to be a video game journalist, just like you guys. And just doing stuff for like FHM and EGM and a lot of 1UP associated pubs. And I kind of branched off and started doing screenwriting for cartoons for like Cartoon Network and Disney and Nickelodeon.
Sounds really fun.
But games have always remained close to my heart, so I always wanted to do some sort of cultural exhibit to some extent. And that's where IMAPIC kind of came from a couple years ago.
So what do you think, what is it about games that lends itself to cultural exploration, do you think? What are you interested in?
It's just like classic movies or really good rock music like Elvis or the Beatles. It's only 20 or 30 years old, like it's not that aged, but but it has that significance to children of the 80s like myself or like you or like our cameraman Ryan O'Donnell.
So do you want to tell us a little bit about some of the examples that you have here?
We kind of went out to artists. We're the gallery in 1988 where the exhibit was in Los Angeles. We kind of split it 50-50. Like, they had their regular arsenal of artists, and I had my friends from animation and the comic book world. So we kind of did a cattle call and said, hey, guys, you want to be in a video game-inspired show? Pick your favorite games and go crazy.
Okay.
So Greg Simpkins, one of the gallery's most prolific artists, if you will.
I've seen his stuff a lot.
He got into the takeoff on all the Pac-Man ghosts. They had their own AI in the original games, like very slight. One was a little faster, one was a little more wily. And so he spun that off into more of an abstract world. But that's what's so cool about these pieces. It's like, it's the artist's interpretation of something so incredibly simple and bitty. Like, you have 10 pixels that make up one ghost. And
how much personality can you extract from pixels?
Absolutely.
And what about this one? I like that one.
This is by Dave Crosland. He's also an LA artist. And he has a love affair with the heroes that never quite get the girl.
So does I Am 8-Bit, I mean, obviously 8-Bit, so it does go back to the 8-Bit era, but I feel like I've seen some more modern.
It embodies 80s as a whole. It's kind of a, you know, we got Mario Kart, we got some references to Street Fighter 2, but it all kind of, it falls in that same area. So it's not specifically 8-Bit, it's all about the mood it evokes.
But it is sort of nostalgic.
Yeah. Okay. And no one can argue that. Games of the 80s were so much better than games of the early 2000s.
Why? What makes them better?
Design, imagination. Like, the limitations kind of allowed for a little crazier plots, a little weirder, you know, character here and there. Like, now it's more about photorealism. It's more about how many hair follicles there is in one character's head, like, and how detailed their eyes are.
Do you think that's sort of barking up the wrong tree, or?
I love Splinter Cell. Like, I'm not a. I don't dismiss all modern games. Like, I have every system known to man in my living room. So, like, I play the Splinter Cells. Like, I love, like, the new Tom Clancy stuff. Like, I love photoreal stuff. But, like, you've got to admit, there's a preoccupation with technology versus creativity these days.
Okay. This is sort of a dark Nintendo universe.
This is by Joe Ledbetter, another LA artist. He's very much influenced by the Cartoon Network generation, if you will, the Dexter's Lab and Powerpuff Girls.
Totally. It looks like,
but he brings that to the fine art world.
Yeah.
So, and he likes to destroy things, so Rampage is very befitting of him.
Yeah, that is so true. That's like the motto of all of us.
That's
probably your motto.
That was. That kind of embodies that statement where, like, I mean, you can kill something to death with just like your favorite song if you play it 300 times. You can kind of destroy it, but it's still just as classic.
This one is neat. Is this oil or chalk?
It's oil on board, on a nice big piece of wood. It's by Jose Amroca Flores, a surfer guy, a surfer artist down in LA. He actually does concept art for Electronic Arts on the Medal of Honor series.
Oh.
You never quite see his work, really, but it's pretty amazing stuff.
That's one of the tragedies, I think, about concept art, is that there's so much great art that's produced in that stage, and hardly any of it ever gets out.
I mean, even looking at the Psychonauts art, like, if you walk through the Double Fine Studios, they have amazing level design stuff, and the game is really well art-directed, and it shows in there, but, like, Scott Campbell and Nathan Stapley and those guys, and Raz, did amazing stuff that, like, you'll never see, and hopefully someone will start printing out books, but we're not Japan, and we can't sell that kind of stuff.
Yeah, why do you think that is? Why do you think Japan can sell so much sort of peripheral, I guess you could say, peripheral goods?
I've yet to figure out why we can't even sell, like, video game soundtracks. Like, you walk into a Japanese game store and there's, like, an entire section of every obscure game you could ever imagine, and it's a soundtrack for it. So, I personally, you release a couple thousand copies and you make some money, it doesn't seem like that much of a harm, but
I think... It doesn't seem like it would be expensive. You've already recorded the music, it's there.
But then again, we have, you know, 50 states to cover and, you know, thousands of miles and shipping. Just like the magazine industry, it's like England has much better magazines because they have much, much smaller terrain to cover. And they can print on nicer paper and it can be a little heavier because it's all done by truck. But when you're flying stuff around, it gets expensive. So I don't think we'll ever have what Japan has or what England has.
Yeah. This is one of my favorite ones. It's one of the early ones, I feel like.
This one's the first pieces to come in, actually, last year. So it kind of embodied the entire...
Yeah, I remember seeing it.
Sean Clarity, the artist, kind of took it into the next dimension and spun that iconic sci-fi image, but, like, into his own little world. And
yeah, I love the... I mean, I love it. It's like the standard, like, dirt bike shot that you always see in extreme sports where it's, like, you know, from below the bike and...
Oh, totally. But what's amazing about it is if you look at the original Excitebike sprite of the ramp jump, it really looks nothing like it. But it's still close enough where it's an instant recognition thing. It's like you would never doubt that that's Excitebike, but if you look at the original sprite, it's still, like, wildly off course. But it's his interpretation. It's like it's what he saw.
Yeah.
So.
I have to admit, it's been a while since I've looked at the original Excitebike.
It's in the book, and I was just looking at it. It's in the masthead. And,
maybe we'll take a look at that later.
Like, side by side, it's pretty crazy.
Hey, we're back here, and you know, this is where the magic's about to happen. This is the other half of how, what goes on the 1UP show. Over here, we got Ryan doing a little bit of editing. How's it going, Ryan?
Pretty good. I'm not actually editing right now, but...
What are you doing?
I'm just playing a little Half-Life 2.
Oh.
Playing Half-Life 2.
On your Mac?
Yeah.
So, wake up, Mr. Freeman. Wake up and smell the ashes.
We don't actually have Final Cut for these new Macs yet. These are the new MacBook Pros with the Intel processors, so I can't actually edit on this machine. I have to edit on my old laptop, but Apple just released a little application called Bootcamp, which allows you to install Windows. It's actually really easy.
Oh my god.
Yeah, wow. It runs perfectly, and you can play games. It's like having a PC and a Macintosh all in one.
Would you ever buy a PC ever again?
I wouldn't. I won't ever buy a PC ever again. I like literally won't. It's amazing. The first night I installed it, I was just like, I couldn't believe it. I was like, this is the beginning of a new era. Now we don't have to think about which hardware to buy anymore.
Did you have to play with the settings at all to make it run like this, or is it pretty much you just like installed it and like installed the game?
Half-Life 2 is super easy. All I did was install the Steam client, log into my account. All my games list was, you know, it's stored on their server, so I just copied it over. It took about an hour to get all the files for Half-Life 2.
Lamar, come out of there!
Uh-oh, everything all right, Dr. Kleiner?
Oh, hello, Alex. Well, almost all right. Lamar has gotten out of her crate again. If I didn't know better, I'd suspect Barney of trapping and... My goodness, Gordon Freeman. It really is you, isn't it?
I found him wandering around outside. Bit of a troublemaker, isn't he?
You know, I wouldn't buy another computer right now. This is like the only computer I would buy.
It's like two in one.
Yeah, it's like getting everything all at once. And it's super, super strong.
But you know, I don't really care about Half-Life 2. What about Oblivion?
Oblivion, eh?
That is what I would install.
Oblivion, when I first started playing, and actually I grabbed some direct feed footage of it, and I was playing with HDR turned on, and it was running, it wasn't running that smooth at all. It was pretty choppy. And, I had to run at a really low resolution. I ended up turning off HDR and just turning normal blue on, and now I'm running it at the native resolution of the display again. It's still kind of choppy, but I know I could get it running better if I tried. I just haven't done that yet. And also, I'll sacrifice frame rate for good looking video, and I get the benefit of all these like really cool mods.
Yeah,
you know.
That's what I'm excited.
Yeah, I really love the mods. I have this thing called BT Mod installed, which allows me to like check out like a larger version of the map, so I can see more stuff at once. It also does the same thing. It kind of makes everything smaller. It makes the interface more like a PC game rather than a console game.
Which actually works much better on a PC than on a television set where you're sitting farther away and maybe you don't want that to be
sure.
So small.
It's so beautiful. Yeah, I wish it ran a little better. But to be honest, like, I could sacrifice the video quality a little bit and get some frame rate back. And but it's just nice to know that I can run any application that I want to run. I can do it all from this machine. Check it out. Oblivion crashed. Actually, crashed when I was closing it. But check it out. Windows. Error report, crash reports on a Mac.
Oh man.
Weird. Yeah, it's a whole new world. It's a whole new world. Anyway, I should probably get back to editing.
Alright.
You guys should go bye-bye. By the way, Jane, how's that Loco Roco thing going?
Let's go check that out.
It's going slowly. Because it's in Japanese. I would say it's actually more than twice as much work because it takes longer to look at the footage and then it also takes longer to edit it because you don't know exactly, you know, what they're saying.
Translate it and
I mean, I do a little bit, but it still helps to have like a professional translator for me anyway, just so that I don't have to worry about like, oh, is that the right word for this, you know? And I like to subtitle also. Yeah. So that's like another layer of something. And this particular interview is an hour long.
The name Loco Roco came from the L and R buttons. I didn't even realize that. That's pretty cool. Can you tell us more about where they came up with the name for Loco Roco?
Yeah, L と R から来たっていうのは後付けで、あの、なんだろう、ゲームの雰囲気に合った、なんか、ゆったりした感じの名前が付けたくて、で、ずっとハワイ語とかの辞書を買って調べてたんですよ。なんか、いいタイトルないかな。で、ずっと悩んでたんだけど、結局いいの出なくて、あの、同期のやつから、ロコロコっていうのを思いついたんだけど、どうっていう。なんとなくハワイ語っぽいし、じゃあそれにしようと。
Do you think that the game is crazy?
Crazy だと思いますか。
そうそう、アホっぽいゲームにしたかったので。ですね、L R を使った理由は、その元々は、ゲームの元々のコンセプトはすごくそのシンプルに、パッと見でゲームのルールが分かって。今 3D のゲームが多くて、みんなカメラ動かすのが難しかったりとか、すごく操作の難しいゲームが多いんですけど、もっとゲームやらない人にもっと遊んでもらいたくて、でとにかく使うボタンを少なくしたかったんですよね。で 2D にすることにしたんですけど、その時に描いたラフ画が、細かいちっちゃいこのロコロコたちが洞窟みたいなところにこういっぱい積み重なってる絵だったんですよ。で最初その1枚のラフ画から始まって、これをどうやって遊ぼうかなって考えていって、傾けたらみんな転がって面白いなとか、積み重なって苦しそうな表情とか、いろんな表情が出せて面白いなとか、電車の中で描いた1枚のラフ書きなんですけど、そこからブワーッとアイデアが膨らんでいって、これも PSP にぴったりだなっていうところから思いついて、あ、 PSP ってここに画面があって、ここにボタンがあって、押したらすぐに反応したらすごくいいなと思って、今回この AI をいっぱい入れてるんですけど、キャラクターの AI を、あのそれはもともと大学の時に、あのそういうゲームを作りたいなと思って、そういう、なんか卒論っていうんですか、大学卒業する時に、そういうテーマを研究して、研究ってほどもやってないんですけど、そういうなんかサンプルのプログラムを作ったんですよ、でビジュアルベーシックで作ったんですよ。でその時に元になる、もう丸描いてちょんちょんって口あるぐらいのキャラクターがいっぱい動き回って、あのなんか喋ったりとか、ほっといたら寝ちゃったりとか、あとお腹空いたらフルーツまで行って食べたりとか、もう本当にこれに近いですね。
Sony think when you introduced the concept to them?
難しい。そこなかなか、あの、いや、評判は良かったような気がしたんですが、何度か企画はダメ出しあって、まあ、すんなりは通らなかったですね。紙だとやっぱり、ただ難しいときに、パワーポイントの、ああいう資料だけだとやっぱ伝わらないんですよね。だからもう動くものを作んなきゃまずいってことで、デモをまず作ったんですよ。今までのゲームが普通に曲流すのが多かったんですよ。BGM として流しちゃって。もっと ゲームせっかくそう操作できて、絵はそれに応じてちゃんと動くのに、曲だけはずっと垂れ流しだったりっていうのが多かったので、もうちょっとそこをちゃんと曲も変化するようなものを作りたかったみたいな。この間の GDC のバージョンだと、昔のやつなので入ってないんですけど、ロコロコ分裂すると、まずコーラスがバッと
増えて、はいはいはいはいはいはいはい
はいはいはいはいはいロコロコの総数全体の数が増えることによって、演奏もだんだん賑やかになっていくようになってます。ずっと音楽ゲームは作りたかったっていうのもあったので、今回やっと自分のゲームは作れるチャンスが来たので、全部やりたいこと入れちゃえと思ってあの 3D のシューティングとかで人を殺すゲームとか多いじゃないですか、でそういうゲームばっかだったんで違うのを作りたかったんですよね。とにかくもう驚かして笑ってるところ見たかったの。ゲームショーでずっと3日間立って横で見てたんですけど、やってるとこもみんな驚いたりとか笑ったりとかしてるのを横で見てて涙出たんですよ。
We're good.
Yeah, is my mic okay? Is volumes? All right. Just make sure. Okay. Hey, yo, check it. Yeah, that's right. We got it here. We just wrapped up the making of the One Up show. And you know how we do it? We did it all hyphy. What up? Yeah. And that's it. So that's a wrap. We'll see you next time on the One Up show. Peace. Woo. Yeah. All right. That's a wrap.
Good. That's a wrap for the real One Up show, too, guys. That's all right. Let's shut this down.
All right, I'll come help you. Hold on, let me put that in the camera real
quick. Thank you. I need some stingers picked up. Next roll's in 15 minutes, people. 15 minutes.
Hey, Melissa.
Jay.
So, if you're going to play me, I have a couple of notes for you that will make it better. Odama is actually a GameCube game, not a GBA game, like you said. I don't want you to make me look too bad up there on the camera. Oh, and another thing. maybe you should think about losing some weight. What a bitch.
I saw that, Mikey.